morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading this morning in the Old Testament comes from 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses 1 through 13, which can be found on page 259 in your pew Bible. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably? He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then sent out and went to Ramah. Now the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. And Saul's servant said to him, "See now, an evil spirit from God is tormenting you. Let our Lord now command the servants who attend you to look for someone who is skillful in playing the lyre. And when the evil spirit from God is upon you, he will play it, and you will feel better." The epistle reading comes from Ephesians chapter 5, verses 8 through 14, which is on page 194 in your pew Bible. "For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light. For the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, 'Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.'" The gospel reading comes from John chapter 9, verses 1 through 41. It's found on page 102 in your pew Bible. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, but it is someone like him. He kept saying, I am the man. But they kept asking him, then how were your eyes opened? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, he put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath. But others said, how can a man who is a sinner perform such signs? And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, what do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened? He said, he is a prophet. The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, he is of age. Ask him. So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered, I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples? Then they reviled him, saying, you are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, you were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us? And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered, and who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. He said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may see. may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." The word of God.
Praise to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. 41 verses in John. She had a workout today, boy. First the Old Testament with those unpronounceable names, and then 41 verses in John.
I told the choir they had to try to stay awake.
Well, let's keep everybody awake today. You can tell from the size of this passage in the Gospel of John immediately that this is an important passage. This is one of those moments in Jesus' ministry that significantly defines what his ministry is all about. As I said in the children's sermon, Jesus saw people, individuals. And Jesus, being Jesus, responded to the need that was so obviously placed in front of him in the lives of individuals. Jesus loved them. Now the disciples have been traveling around with him for a bit of a time. And it seems that in this discipleship training program, Jesus was trying to get them to break free from their historic cultural paradigm and see people. Jesus sees this man born blind. And the disciples are having some progress. They see him too, a man born blind, and trying to impress, I think, the master. They raise a theological question that so typifies the world that they are a part of. So Jesus, man born blind, who sinned? This man or his parents? I mean, in the Old Testament, there was this construct about occasionally God getting so upset that judgment came upon not only the individual, but the third and fourth generation, whatever that might mean. And it was usually very rare, and it was usually something pretty, pretty serious. Who sinned, this man or his parents? That entire culture went to an A to B to C kind of logic. And if it is A to B to C, then certainly they thought C to B to A. But it is not. There were many reasons. Many reasons why things happened. There's no need to fall immediately into categorization of blame. There's no reason to do the blame game. Here's a guy standing in front of you. He can't see. He was born blind. Who cares about the blame game if you love that person? And Jesus says, neither he nor his parents, but that the works of God may be made manifest in him. Here's that Jesus philosophy again. He sees the man born blind and loves him, and sees an opportunity to do the works of God. And he makes spittle, and he makes clay, and he puts it on the man's eyes, and he sends him over to the pool of Siloam, which means, by the way, sent. And he washes his eyes, and he can see. Wow. The community's reaction is much like the disciples. When he shows himself coming back from the pool of Siloam, people start to buzz. You know how it is. We live in a small town. Is that the guy? I don't think that's the guy. He doesn't look, well, he sort of looks like it. Maybe with his blindness, he was some way contorted. I don't think that's the guy. This guy can see. The other guy couldn't see. I mean, you can just hear the banter. The community see a blind man. And when he was healed, they didn't know what to do with him. He was defying the It's the Sabbath. And in our theology, of course, doing the work on the Sabbath, that's not allowed. That's sin. Jesus did a work on the Sabbath. That's sin. He didn't do it right. He didn't follow the construct, our interpretation of right and wrong and that which is religious. You see, in the Pharisaic system, even doing a work of God was forbidden. And they start running around themselves, bending over backwards, to try to condemn Jesus and to condemn the Word and get all the stuffing back in the pillow that's been punctured. They just don't know what to do. They go to the man's parents. Family systems theory, right? Gotta love it. So what's this all about with your son? Parents are like, he's a grown man. I'm not touching this. I don't want to get excommunicated. Go ask him. The family, the parents, essentially throw him under the bus and abandon him. Wow. They go to the man. And this man is both simple and astute in his reactions to the Pharisees. For him, it's pretty simple. One thing I know, I was blind, but now I see. And all his answers just further annoy and outrage and upset the established systematic system of the Pharisees and Judaism, which is bending over backwards and running around town trying to explain away what happened right in front of them. Finally, in their frustration, they essentially excommunicate the man from the religious environment. They cast him out. And he runs into Jesus again. And he says to Jesus, I believe. Not only did he get his sight in the literal visual sense, but in the midst of a bankrupt, corrupt, blaming, judgmental, individual denying, God's work denying system, he says, oh no, because of what happened to me, I see that I am grateful. And he became a believer in Jesus Christ. It's kind of like that old song, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Jesus wants us to see. He wants us to see people, individuals, resonate with their suffering and extend to them Christ's love through us and our love to them. And when you do, you never know. You might rattle the cages of the community. You might rattle the religious cages too. You might rattle the family system cages. But this loving is God's work made manifest. Jesus sent him to that pool called Siloam. We bow